Okay, good morning, everybody. This is another seminar organized by the Instituto de Astrofísica de Andalucía in Granada, Spain. And today we will have the talk of Dr. Ignacio Trujillo from the Instituto de Astrofísica de Andalucía, de Canarias, sorry, in Canary Island, and also. And he will talk about Unveiling the Low Surface Brightness Universe. Dr. Ignacio Trujillo, he made his PhD thesis on Instituto de Astrofísica Canarias, finishing in 2002. And then he moved to the Max Planck Institute for Astronomy at Heidelberg from doing a postdoctoral fellow there. Then he moved another time from 2005-2007 to the University of Nottingham as a research assistant. And then he came back to Spain with a Ramón y Cajal fellowship to IIC. Then in 2012, he got the staff position as científico titular, and then he was moved to investigador científico in 2018. So thank you very much, Nacho, for this giving us this talk, and the floor is yours, as you want.
Thank you very much, René, and thanks for allowing me to give you this seminar. I'm very happy to be able to talk to you this morning, and I'm going to present you a number of results that we have been doing in the last 5 years or so. And of course, this is not the work of only one person. It's the work of a lot of persons. And I'm particularly thanking to all the people that you can see here listed, which are a fantastic group of people. And without their help and their effort, this would have been never possible. So let me start, because we are going to talk about the low surface brightness universe, giving you a reference of how the humanity has been able to improve her knowledge of the low surface brightness universe with time. So as you know, if we go to a dark spot on a dark night, we can see very low surface brightness features like our galaxy, or even the central regions of nearby galaxies like the galaxy M31. And that has been the access to the low surface brightness universe of the humankind for many thousand years. That very diffuse light that the eye can see is in the units that we are going to be talking about during all the talk, about 16 magnitudes per square second. So you can have a reference of what we have improved with time with respect to that very faint features that we can see just with the naked eye. So at the beginning of the 17th century, everything changed because the invention of the telescope. Here you have the Galileo telescope, and here you have an example of a current telescope. This is the Sloan telescope. And with these new telescopes, we are now currently able to go up to 10,000 times fainter than with the naked eye, so that will correspond typically to surface brightness of the order of 26.5 magnitudes per square second. So this is the typical view, the typical depth that you have when you see a normal image of a telescope like Sloan. Okay, so this is the typical depth that you see in this kind of images is around 26.5 magnitudes per square second. But something that maybe you are not so aware of is that if we were able to see the sky at this kind of limiting brightness, the objects that we would be able to see, galaxies, nebulae, explosion of supernovae, and so forth, are enormous on the sky. So normally, when you think on this, you think on a small objects, but when you really see how they are, how they large they are in comparison, for example, with the full moon, you can see that they are really, really, really big. So the reason why don't we see it is because, contrary to the stars that have all the light concentrated in just a single point, when you distribute all that light in a large region, the surface brightness is low. So 26 and a half is what we have as a standard today, but we knew from a lot of time, from 50 years or so, that if you can go definitely deeper with the current technology. So for example, here, you have a picture of M83 with a typical telescope, the typical picture of the galaxy, but since the pictures, the photographic plate by David Bailing, we know that there are a lot of low superbrightness features surrounding these galaxies. So it's possible to go deeper than the typical image of Sloan, but it's hard. It's quite hard. So the reason is why it's so hard to get images deeper than that. Well, we have a number of reasons or a number of technical challenges. The first one is that, you know, is that the atmosphere is not is bright. So it's in fact very bright. In terms of super brightness, the typical air glow, so which is this green light that we have here, but of course we have over the entire atmosphere, is of the order of 22 magnitudes per square second. So way much brighter than what we see on the outer part of the galaxies. So this air glow is produced by the ionization of the atmosphere, of the atoms on the atmosphere, and then late because of the sun, because of the light of the sun, and then at night these atoms are recombined and emit this greenish light that is producing this high brightness. However, we know how to deal with this is because this is variable. If you integrate long enough, you just simply reduce the brightness, and then you just subtract this light, and then you can see objects that are fainter. However, another technical challenge that you have is that when you go even brighter, when you try to cross 26 magnitudes per square second, then we have a lot of limitations produced by the reflections and artifacts of the light that reflects on the structures like the dome, the structure of the telescope, that produce a lot of artificial structures, gradients, and so forth in our data. So there are ways to deal with this. Some of them are simplifying the optics of the telescope. For example, trying to minimize the number of surface where the light is it's reflecting. Or another possibility, which is produce clever observing strategy where you try to move the telescope up and down, right, left, so to avoid as much as possible all these reflections. So we know how to deal with this as well, but then when we go and try to push even deeper, we have a problem that is inherent to the fact that we are observing through the atmosphere. And also if you go to the space, you have that problem as well, but in a more limited effect, which is the scatter light produced by the sources itself that you have on the image. For example, this is a region on the sky, and you can see all these sources that are a combination of galaxies and stars. If you go very faint, there is all this scatter light around the objects that is produced by the effect of the point spread function. So either you have an exquisite characterization of the point spread function, and therefore you are able to deconvolve somehow this light, or you are very much affected by this. In fact, if you are able to reach 29.5 magnitudes per square second, basically every single pixel of your image is affected by this light, no matter where you really look. But in addition to these technical challenges, we have another challenge. This time is a natural challenge, which is the fact that we have galactic cirri. So if you go, for example, to this image of M81 and M82, and you go and you make a deep exposure, you can see that surrounding these galaxies, there's a lot of diffuse structure, which corresponds to the dust of our own galaxy. So normally when you think for the very first time on this, you think, okay, there would be plenty of spots on the sky, just go to the North Pole or to the South Pole and just avoid these regions with galactic dust. However, this is not at all real because the galactic dust really expands over the entire sky. And the reason is that we don't have only the concentration of dust in the disk of the galaxy, but also we have a lot of clouds and columns of dust very nearby to the Earth that are covering a lot of the sky. So in fact, only few spots on the sky are free of dust features. So this is a very important problem on the when we want to explore the very low surface brightness universe, and we need to know how to handle it. So because of the interest of going deeper and the possibility of discovering new phenomenon, in the last 5 years, more or less, there has been an explosion of groups in the world trying to push the frontiers of the low surface brightness. And in fact, we can think on efforts by Pierre Alain Duc and the MATLAS group with the CFEHT, a 3.6 meter telescope. Then we have also Mijos that has been a pioneer on the deep exploration of the universe using the 0.9 meter telescope, the Barrel Smith. Then we have, of course, David Martinez Delgado, which has been a pioneer also on very deep studies using a telescope of the order of half a meter, an amateur telescope. Somehow, by amateur, I mean that they are, in fact, when you look at them, they are really professional and handled by really good people. And then we have, for example, efforts lead here, they see using the Stripe 82, the deep region of the Sloan. And also we have also other ideas, like, for example, the Dragonfly telescope, which consists on an array of a lot of small lenses, trying to minimize the problems of the structure on top of the telescope. So all these surveys typically go one order of magnitude deeper than Sloan, which correspond to go to around 100,000 times fainter than with the naked eye, and typical depths of the order of 28.5 magnitudes per square second. So if you look at the universe at such a depth, this is how it looks. For example, this is again M31, the Andromeda galaxy, compared to the full moon. And you can see what I was saying, that if you go to 28.5, it's very difficult not to find galactic cirri everywhere. So this is how the sky looks like when you go around 2 magnitudes deeper than with the Sloan. So what is the kind of science that we can do when we go to such a depth? So we have been talking about galactic cirri. So this is of interest for the people that wants to study the interstellar medium, for example. So this is from a paper by Javier Roman that was at the Instituto de Astrofísica Andalucía only a few months ago. And here you have a comparison of the same region by Sloan and the same region by the Stripe 82, which is 2 magnitudes deeper. And you can clearly see how all these galactic cirri appear only by going 2 magnitudes deeper. So what we have found in this paper is something that I think is very interesting, which is the following. So here you have an example of an extended galactic cirrus, in comparison with the size of the moon. At this time, this image is showing the emission in the far infrared at 250 micron, observed by the Herschel telescope, of the cirrus. Okay, so if you go to 28.5 magnitudes in the R band, you see that there is an almost perfect correlation between the emission on the infrared of the galactic cirrus and the reflection of that light in the optical in the R band, for example. So you can see it's an almost identical one-to-one correlation. And also, it's interesting to see that if you look at the colors in the optical of this galactic series, what we see is a very nice trend between the emission in the infrared of this galactic series, so the brighter the series, the redder the color in the G minus R, the redder the color in the R minus I, but interestingly, there is almost a flat correlation, almost no relation at all between the color in the very red part of the optical band and the emission in the infrared. So this is interesting because if you compare the typical color of the galactic Sirri in comparison with the tracks of the typical stars, the colors of the stars. So this is the R minus I color versus the G minus R. So these are stellar populations of galaxies from the Vasdekis models. And this is the distribution of the colors of real galaxies in the same images, okay? So what you can see is that there is, because of the colors of the galactic Sirri in the optical, maybe there is an opportunity to distinguish between the low surface brightness features that have a stellar population origin, like in galaxies and so forth, from those that came from the interstellar medium, the galactic Sirri. So in fact, we did a nice example, I think, where you have here very deep data from the hypersupran camera. And this is a cluster of galaxies. And as you can see, it's plenty of galactic Sirri. But if you make this color separation, you can see how nicely the color separation was able to distinguish between the location of the galaxies and the location of the galactic Sirri. So this, of course, need to be confirmed by other groups. But in principle, there's a possibility, a tool to segregate dust from galaxies at an arc second resolution, something that is only possible right now in the optical. So when you don't have access, for example, to high resolution far infrared images, this would be maybe the way to move forward in the possibility of studying the structure of all these interstellar medium. Another interesting thing that another scientific case that you can have when you go to 28 and a half magnitudes per square second is the possibility of exploring the outer part of the galaxy. So something that we have found is that even if you go to magnitudes deeper than with the typical Sloan data, for example, this is a galaxy that is like the Milky Way, but relatively nearby, NGC 4565. So this is data taken with the William Herschel telescope, 4 hours in filter G, R, and I. So it's a very deep image. So you can see that even if we go very deep, apparently the galaxy doesn't grow much, okay? So there is like a truncation, so an end of the stellar population that we can use to rethink, for example, the concept of the size of the galaxy. For example, look at this. Here is the profile along the semi-major axis of this galaxy in the near ultraviolet, in the R band, and in the 3.6 micron. And you can see that around 27 kiloparsec, which correspond to this position here, there is a significant drop on the light. Let me wait a second to drink a bit of water. So we can consider, for example, using this drop to measure the size of the galaxies, a new way of measuring the size of the galaxy and explore how this affects to our understanding of how the galaxies are. So this, this size indicator that would be connected to the star formation threshold is also somehow motivated theoretically. This is from a paper by Tsai 2004, where he predicted that the gas density would be only able to form stars as soon as it gets denser than this value. So considering the typical star formation efficiency of the order of 30% or less, that would correspond typically to a value of around 1 solar masses per parsec square for the stars, for the star density, the stellar density. And in fact, this corresponds to the density of a star that we have here. So based on that, we propose to measure the size of the galaxies using approximately this value. And to our surprise, when we use this measure for a new size estimation based on the 1 solar mass per parsec square density, we found that basically all type of galaxies from M87-like to Milky Ways and dwarf galaxies, you can see how nicely the 1 solar mass per parsec square is capable of enclosing basically all the stars of the galaxies. So what happens if we use that as a size indicator in general? So let me, before moving to that, compare the size based on the location of the star formation threshold with the size that you get if you use instead the effective radius. So this is the location of the effective radius for the same galaxies. And you can see that the effective radius only encloses the most inner part of the galaxies. So definitely when you use the effective radius, you are not covering the entire structure at all, only the innermost region, and depends a lot on the amount of light that you have in the central region. Sorry. This is the size versus the stellar mass comparing the effective radius, the blue points, versus the new size indicator based on the star formation threshold. And you can see immediately that with the new definition of the size, the scatter of the relation decreased significantly. And in fact, also in the region of the masses of the Milky Way-like galaxies, so this region around a few times 10 to the 10, so while here we have a significant scatter, and you cannot clearly say just based on this, on the effective radius, what kind of galaxies do you have, in that same region, if you use the star formation threshold, you still see a nice increasing trend, right? Also, you can see that there is a nice correlation, a nice trend, just including dwarf and spiral galaxies. And only on the most massive above 10 to 11, there is an increase on the size of the galaxies based on this new size indicator. If you consider also that the scatter that we are showing is an observational scatter and therefore is not the intrinsic scatter. So if you try to calculate the intrinsic scatter of the relation, after deconvolving by the effect of the error of mass and other observations, you can see that the scatter is extremely narrow. The intrinsic scatter is only of the order of 0.06 dex. So it's around three times smaller than the scatter that you have using the effective radius. And also, and we are very excited for that. So we are capable of recovering the same low scatter and trend using the new state-of-the-art Eagle simulation, cosmological simulations, and where we find a very nice trend between the size defined by the star formation threshold and the masses of the objects. And such a wonderful correlation, this is a work in progress, allow us in principle to be to have the possibility of connecting directly the dark matter halo properties of the galaxies, just having access to the size. In addition to that, because the new definition of size encloses where the star formation is, it's a nice way of segregating between in situ star formation versus ex situ star formation, like those stars that are coming, for example, from the outer, sorry, I'm losing my voice, from the outer part. Yeah, sorry about that. Another option that we have is to explore very diffuse galaxies if you go to 28.5 magnitudes per square second. And in fact, in the last 5 years, the extragalactic community has been revolutionized by the following discovery, which was this paper by the group of Dragonfly, which said that they have found in the Coma cluster 47 galaxies with the size of the Milky Way, but very diffuse. Here you have the discovery paper, where they show the effective radius with the new objects and versus the super brightness. the central surface brightness of the object comparing with the Milky Way. Okay, the Milky Way have a central surface brightness of the order of 20 in this notation, the disk of the Milky Way. And here you have the typical surface brightness below 24 with the definition by the Dragonfly team. And you have an example of an ultra-diffuse galaxy. So these galaxies are characterized by having central surface brightness fainter than 24 and effective radius 1.5 kiloparsec. So because apparently they are the size of the Milky Way and so diffuse, there was a lot of interest for exploring these studies, these objects in detail. In addition, because the same group found that some of these objects were extremely dark matter dominated. In fact, some claim for some of these objects being only dark matter, basically, like the case of Dragonfly 44, which they found being a galaxy with only 10 to the 8 solar masses, but having 100 globular clusters. So I will go into more detail with this. Also, sometimes they also have found some galaxies which are really the opposite, like Dragonfly 2 and Dragonfly 4, where based on the kinematics of the globular cluster, they have found that the velocity dispersion of the globular cluster group is extremely low, of the order of 8 kilometers a second, or even in the case of the Dragonfly 4, only 4 kilometers a second. So fully compatible with the idea that these galaxies, which are also of the order of 10 to the 8, are only dominated by the stellar populations and not, they don't need to have dark matter. So as you can see, we have examples of some of these objects being very special, okay? So let me go through to a summary of what I think is going on with these galaxies. So, The very first thing that I think we need to understand is that when the claim that these galaxies have the size of the Milky Way is based on the measure of the effective radius. But if you look at these galaxies and you put them into comparison with the typical galaxies we are typically exploring, like an M87 or a Milky Way-like, an ultra-diffuse galaxy like this, which is a large ultra-diffuse galaxy, in fact, when you look at the images which have the same depth and they have been put at the same spatial resolution, the appearance, the visual appearance of these galaxies is not larger than a regular dwarf. It is true that they have less light in the center, but in terms of what you can see, they definitely doesn't look like a Milky Way. So what is going on? So in my interpretation, as I have said before, the use of the effective radius is a misleading indicator of the size of a galaxy. So it doesn't give you a right impression of how extended an object is. For example, this galaxy, which has been considered as an analog of the Milky Way, if you look at the effective radius, because most of the light is concentrated on the bulge, this is the size of the effective radius. So you can see that doesn't represent at all the size or the spatial extension of the galaxy. Compare this with the Dragonfly 44, which is one of the largest ultra-diffuse galaxies. So this is the effective radius. The effective radius in this galaxy, because they don't have a light central concentration, they are very diffuse, it's almost the size, the visual appearance of the galaxy in the image, okay? But although they have the same effective radius, definitely this galaxy it doesn't have the extension of a Milky Way. So in fact, they have the extension of a dwarf. So in relation to this galaxy, to Dragonfly 44, which I remember you all was the galaxy that was claimed to be almost entirely composed of dark matter. This claim came from the following observations. So originally, they found there were like 100 globular clusters and a high velocity dispersion that would correspond to a dark matter halo of 10 to the 12, so similar to the dark matter halo of a galaxy like the Milky Way. Further observations for the same group decreased the number of globular clusters to 74, and also the velocity dispersion was also remeasured and decayed to 33. And the dark matter halo was continuously decreasing because of that. So in a recent work by Deimos Saifolahi, what we found was that we remeasured the number of globular clusters of this galaxy, and we found that there was a way much less number of globular clusters compared to the original claims. And the reason was that in the first paper, they were assuming a particular distribution of the globular cluster that that put many of them very far away. So they were overcounting the number of globular clusters. When you study the distribution of the globular cluster and you use the distribution that you see, then this number of globular clusters decay a lot. And when you take into account the low number of globular clusters and together with the new version of the velocity dispersion, then the dark matter halo decreased by an order of magnitude. And the final amount of mass in this galaxy, it's more or less similar to the one that you find in regular dwarf. This result also of the low number of globular clusters was also confirmed by X-ray studies by Bogdan last year. So far I would say there's no obvious evidence that this galaxy has more dark matter than expected. Then of course there has been such an important controversy on the galaxies without dark matter, that are called the Dragonfly 4, which is this one, and Dragonfly 2, which is here. So these two galaxies are that are controversial are on the same line of sight, basically, which is the line of sight of the massive elliptical galaxy 10 to the 52. But there is also another galaxies in the same line of sight, which are way more closer, like NGC 1042. So while this, what we are proposing is that in the same line of sight there are two different groups. One group that is at 20 megaparsec that correspond to NGC 1052, and another group associated to NGC 1042, which is this spiral galaxy here, that is at only 13 megaparsec away. And the distance is absolutely key and relevant to know whether these two low super brightness galaxies, Dragonfly 2 and Dragonfly 4, has little dark matter or has a regular amount of matter. Because the closer the galaxy is, the more normal the amount of dark matter you have. So this is a compilation of distances that we have used in 2019. And this is the measure that this is for Dragonfly 2. In the group by Van Dokkum using the super brightness fluctuation got 20 megaparsec. And if we use instead the tip of the red giant brand, the globular cluster luminosity function, the size of the globular cluster, the comparison with other stellar populations, and also super brightness fluctuation method, we got a distance which was closer. So in that sense, we didn't find any special reason for thinking that Dragonfly 2 has a very low dark matter content. However, so just to finish on this, if you use the new size indicator, the Dragonfly 2 galaxy was claimed to be special, exactly follow the other trends of regular galaxies with the other regular dwarf galaxies with the same mass, brightness, and so forth. So not having any reason for thinking that this galaxy is particularly new. However, the other galaxy, Dragonfly 4, was extremely interesting because if you remember, the velocity dispersion of the globular clusters of this galaxy was extremely low. So it was compatible with being only 4 kilometers a second. So even at a distance of 13 megaparsec, Dragonfly 4 is compatible with not having dark matter. So have we finally found a galaxy without dark matter? Well, what we did was to continue studying this galaxy was to use the IC80 telescope. It's an 80 centimeter telescope here in Tenerife. And what we did was to explore this galaxy by making a super deep exposure of 60 hours, okay? And what we found was, this is by a paper by Mireia Montes, 2020, is that there are indications and that this galaxy, Dragonfly 4, is interacting with this nearby galaxy, NGC 1035, which is also confirmed to be closer, no, at 13 megaparsec. So here you have the same image, this time removing the contamination of this galaxy and this star, and you can see clearly signatures of tidal features, so implying that this galaxy is undergoing a tidal disruption with a nearby object, in this case, very likely this galaxy. So we confirm that the Dragonfly 4 has very little dark matter compatible with the low velocity dispersion of the cluster, but we find also a very natural explanation for that. So the interaction with of Dragonfly 4 with this nearby galaxy is it has removed the dark matter halo of the galaxy and is now starting to also disrupt the stellar population of the object. So this has been examples of science cases that we are able to do if we go to 28 and a half magnitudes, but it's possible to go 10 times deeper. And it's so what kind of science cases we can do that we cannot do with the current deep. So if we were able to go beyond 30 magnitudes per square second, so in the sense of going nearly 1 million times fainter than with the naked eye, so look at how impressive the Andromeda galaxy would look again on the sky. So this is for comparison, the size of the moon. And you can see that the going up to beyond 30 magnitudes per square second would show us Andromeda with all the streams, all the halo structure. And it would be such a huge object on the night sky that even maybe with the entire hand, you cannot cover the object completely. So you can see how amazing it would be to see the sky at such depth. But of course, going beyond 30 magnitudes per square second is extremely, extremely complicated. So the science cases that one would be able to address if we were able to go beyond 30 magnitudes per square second are very, very interesting. For example, the predictions from the cosmological simulation is that if you go beyond 30 magnitudes per square second, so toward the blue in these simulations, we would be able to resolve the stellar halo of individual galaxies. So these are Milky Way-like galaxies according to cosmological simulation. And you can see that if we go beyond 30, the objects would be huge, would be enormous. This scale here are in kiloparsecs. So this tiny region, which corresponds to the disk of the galaxy, would be transformed now into a huge structure, nearly 10 times larger in size. So we should be able to see this structure in every, basically in every galaxy, according to the cosmological simulation. Moreover, we should be able to explore a very important problem, which is the so-called missing satellite problem, which, as you know, means that the number of dark matter halos, the number of, dark matter halos surrounding, for example, objects like the Milky Way are way much more larger than the number of satellites that we actually see. As you know, this has been a huge debate of 20 years, exploring what is the difference between the number of predicted satellite halos and the number of observed satellite galaxies. So having access to very deep images of a large sample of Milky Way-like galaxies in the nearby universe at this depth will allow us to explore all this region in detail and see whether maybe, for whatever reason, the Milky Way and M31 are unique or not. And finally, if we go very, very deep, we should be able to explore another interesting feature, which is the intracluster light. As you know, the intracluster light is all this diffuse light that is surrounding the central galaxy in clusters, and is thought to be formed by the evolution of the structure of the cluster that after, so this is starting at redshift 2. So after all this disruption and interaction between the galaxies, later on you form this diffuse light. So accessing to this diffuse light would be give us a lot of information about how this structure has been formed and evolved with time. So let me tell you what we have done in this sense. So this is an example of a galaxy like M33 that we have observed 5 hours in the G-band and another 5 hours or so in the R-band with the GTC telescope, and where we have compared what we see when we go to different depths. So this is the image of a Sloan. So nothing around. In the stripe 82, basically nothing around. When you allocate with a 1 meter telescope 50 hours and you start observing some features, and when you go with the GTC and observe 5 hours, you definitely found a lot of structures surrounding the galaxy. So most of our deep star base, the ones that I have been talking before, finishes around here. So Dragonfly, the Barrel-Smith, CVHT, and so forth. So you can see that you really need to cross or go very close to 30 magnitudes per square second to start observing all these filaments in galaxies such as small like M33, for example. So, but if you go to such depths, your images are very unique, okay? Because basically, there are only a handful of galaxies where you can go so deep, that demands a lot of telescope time. So how do we know, how are we sure that we can really, that the features that we observe are real? Okay, to be sure, we need to compare, for example, two different bands, no? It's like the G band and the R band. And you can see that most of the structures surrounding the galaxy, the stellar stream and so forth, are reproducible in the two bands. And sometimes when they are not, like for example, this feature here that basically it cannot be seen in the G band, but it's visible in the R band, very, very clear. This is because it's a filament of galaxies at redshift 0.7, and therefore in the G band it's in the ultraviolet and they're almost invisible, okay? So this is also further demonstration that we in fact are able to go to such an extremely depth of 31 magnitudes per square second. Also, another science that we can do is the following, which I found extremely interesting as well. So if we go to the faintest galaxies that we are able to see, for example, with the Stripe 82, like in this case, so we know that these galaxies are right now forming stars because of the bluer color they have. So we know that if when the star formation stops here, and if we make them evolve with time, these objects are going to disappear from our catalogs because they are going to be so faint, like 2 magnitudes fainter, that they are basically not going to be observed even with the present deep data. So one question that we can ask is how many of these objects are we missing? Okay, this has some relevance for the study of what are so-called the dark galaxies, okay? Here you have an example of what we are doing in this sense. So this is again the Sloan data. So you can see nothing here. Stripe 82, you barely see any, very little. And then when you point with the GTC telescope for a few hours, then you observe extremely faint object with a central surface brightness below 27 magnitudes per square second. So what are the properties of these galaxies is something that we need to study. Now we have confirmed a redshift through radio emission of the hydrogen. And we are now working on a paper to see what are the characteristics of these extremely faint objects compared to the regular population or to the population of faint objects that we have in the local group. And finally, with this I'm going to finish, is the study of the intracluster light. So I'm going to finish discussing an idea that I find also extremely exciting, which is the possibility of using the intracluster light as a new tool to see the dark matter distribution. So what is the basis for that? So the intracluster light, as I said before, is formed by the stars that has been disrupted by the galaxy's interactions when the cluster is being formed. And therefore, because they are just stars, they are a cold, collisionless component that is floating freely on the gravitational potential of the cluster. So in principle, they only should follow the entire gravitational potential of the cluster and not those of individual galaxies. and it could be similar or as expected as the dark matter, if particularly if the dark matter is called dark matter, okay? Because it's also cold and collisionless. So in principle, they should distribute equally. Is that the case? To explore this, what we, sorry, I don't know what's going on here. Oops, something happened, sorry. Oops. So what we did was to take the frontier field clusters, which are a combination of clusters in the deepest observation of clusters done by the Hubble Space Telescope. Here you have, which correspond to six clusters. Where we have a lot of information because they were taken. These images were taken to explore all these arcs and use the strong gravitational lensing of the cluster to explore the highest redshift objects, no? Redshift 10, redshift 12. But what we did was to use these images to explore the distribution of the very diffuse light, the intracluster light. And what we did was to compare this intracluster light with the mass distribution that you get when you make the mass map based on the strong lensing. So here, what you have is the intracluster light contours in green and the dark matter contours in these pink images, okay? And what we found is that at the level of the mass resolution of the strong lensing maps, the agreement between the distribution of the intracluster light and the distribution of the dark matter was exactly the same, exactly, and within the errors, no difference. So this was confirmed or studied, let's say, theoretically, by the group using cosmological simulation, the Siegel cosmological simulations, and they found that in fact in the simulation the distribution of stars and dark matter was exactly the same as well. So if this is confirmed in more clusters, we have the opportunity of just making deep images to see how the dark matter is distributed, okay? But I would say something even more. So with deeper observations and with better mass maps, what we can do is to study whether in fact this agreement is perfect, or we start observing differences between the distribution of the dark matter and the intracluster light. And if that is the case, that would be so exciting because it would say that the dark matter requires, that the dark matter is maybe interacting with itself and departuring from the idea that is purely collisionless. So somehow we will see in the next year whether we have found a way of exploring the ultimate nature of the dark matter by seeing how they depart from the hypothesis of being fully cold, like it currently is. So this is my last slide. So I think that with the current technology, we are able to go up to a million times fainter than with the naked eye. And that is allowing us to explore a huge amount of new phenomena, very diffuse galaxies, the intracluster light, knowing the properties of the interstellar medium with the extremely exquisite spatial resolution, and so forth. So I leave you with this very diffuse features that resembles like a ghost. And as you know, so if you want to know more, please just click on our webpage and I'm happy to answer your questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nacho, for this very nice talk. This last image is really nice, really impressive. So now the talk is open for questions. Please raise your hand. For doing that, go to the reaction button, and then you can find the raise your hand. I have one here. Okay, Isabel. Please.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, very nice.
So first of all, thanks so much, Ignacio. Nacho, this has been a great talk. I've loved it. It's very interesting. So I have several short questions, I think. So the first one is, I think I didn't understand the meaning of the size that you give in terms of solar masses, one solar mass per parsec square or something like that. Since then, in the later plots, you put levels of those of different, let's say, mass densities, so including one solar mass per parsec square, and it doesn't follow the line, so properly.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yes. Let me go to the slide. I'm very sorry about my voice today. So I think I have a small cold, and I'm sorry about that.
If it is a small cold, it's good.
Okay, yes. Anyway, I'm at home, so I'm not going to contaminate anyone. Yes, so this is the these trends here. Mm-hmm. Corresponds to the this would be the density, the average density of an object that is that it inside. For example, here you have 10 solar, this is 10 to the 10, okay? So if it has a size of 2 kiloparsecs, the average density would be that value. So this is an average density. Mm-hmm. And this, however, our definition is to find, because of what we have said, theoretically motivated, to identify the location of the star formation threshold, and because that will require a lot of study, we propose as a proxy to use the stellar density at one solar masses per parsec square. Okay, so what this is telling us is that, you have it again, that if you take that, which is the density in the outer part, in this plot, what you see is that the average density of the galaxy that you study, for example, a Milky Way, would have an average density of a few times, so a few hundreds, like 100, 200, but this is the average density.
Mm-hmm. So in fact, what is telling you is that you have a smooth transition of increasing densities from
For example, look at the, for example, in the case of the Milky Way, we have an average density of a few hundred. In the case of a very small galaxy, like 10 to the 8, the average density is only 10 solar masses per square.
Okay.
So it has been an increase of a factor of 10 in density, mm-hmm. just moving from 10 to the 8 to 10 to the 11, for example.
Okay, so the next thing is that have you tested how the H1 is distributed in such a low surface brightness in stars?
You mean for the ultra-diffuse galaxies or here?
Or in general, when you get to so deep magnitudes, I mean low surface brightnesses, have you tried to check whether, because the sizes, we already know that H1 is much more farther away distributed than the optical. So how does it compare?
Very nice question, Isabel, because in fact, as you know, if you use a hydrogen and you use a very similar definition of size in hydrogen, which is the one solar mass per square in density in hydrogen, you also get a very narrow scatter as well. So it would be a very similar plot. Of mm-hmm. course, here, instead of using stars, you can use hydrogen, for example. So answering to your question more directly, what we are now doing is to take high resolution hydrogen distribution to see whether at which density in hydrogen we found these features of the star formation threshold, no? For example, this kind of truncations that we are finding, okay? So what we are exploring is to see or try to measure directly what is the conversion efficient between, so how many, what is the density of the hydrogen at these regions compared to the density of stars, to really try measuring the star formation efficiency more than to just figure it out. And another interesting thing connected to that is the following. So as you know, when you go to hydrogen images, hydrogen maps, we see a huge extension. And sometimes the disk is enormous compared, the hydrogen disk is enormous compared to the stellar disk, okay? So what happens if we go deeper and deeper and deeper? Are we able to see stars also at such a large distances, although with a very low density? My impression, although we still, this is work in progress, is that basically every feature that we have observed in hydrogen has a counterpart in stars as well. So, and I found this extremely important because normally, if I tell you, look at the 30, 40 kiloparsecs away from the center of a galaxy like the Milky Way, everybody would agree that you are exploring the dark matter halo, for example, you know, the region of the dark matter halo. Mm-hmm. However, if you look at the hydrogen, it's containing this shape. And also we are capable of exploring the stellar distribution there, that made me think that maybe in the next 10 years or so, we need to rethink a little bit of all these studies of stellar halos as well, because maybe in the end, we found that the star distribution is also in a planar configuration more than in an spherical configuration. So yeah, so a lot of things to explore with the new technology, yes.
Yeah, so that's it. Yeah, and so another comment that I'd like to raise is that when we will have the Vera Rubin telescope working, I hope we will be able to get incredibly deep images.
Well,
so but the amount of information will be huge. So I don't know where you're moving in that direction.
I don't have I can tell you the typical brightness that we would expect with the at the end of the survey of the Vera Rubin telescope, we would have typical depths of the order of typical integration in one spot of the order of 1-2 hours of an 8 meter of in this case a 6 meter 6.5 effectively meter telescope. So that is going to produce observations of the order of a few, you know, 30.5 magnitudes per square second. So we are going to be really at the limit. So we are going to be something in between here. So if the reductions are well done, then we would be able to explore all these stellar halos and particularly all the faint dwarf around these objects. But this would be in 10 years' time. Now, what I can tell you, although I haven't saw anything because this is work in progress, is that we have started now with the Large Binocular Telescope a survey with the typical depths that we expect from the Vera Rubin telescope, in a couple of in a dozens of galaxies like the Milky Way to see what we should expect. So I hope to put this into the archive very soon.
And that possibly it will allow to see even filaments between clusters, something like that. So
let's see, because I mean, the reductions are really complicated. At these levels, systematics are extremely important, very important. So yeah, so it would, I'm optimistic in the sense that we would be able to see it, but probably it will require a specific reduction of the data to get that from the images. With the current reduction techniques, you don't get it.
Okay, thank you very much, Nacho.
Thanks to you, Isabel.
And congratulations.
Thank you, Isabel. We have another question. Jaime, please.
Can you hear me?
Yep.
Hola, Jaime.
Hola. Okay, so I have a couple of questions. Well, there were three, but Isabel made the question related to the H1. Just a comment on the H1. And the H1 distension, I think it was going to be more or less similar. But you can have the kinematics also, that in your case is going to be much more difficult.
Yes.
So in that sense, the studies is going to be complementary.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. Going to the other level of temperature, that the hot side, have you compared your images in the cluster with the X-ray images that they are around?
Yes, it's a very good question. Yeah. So because in the past, X-ray were claimed to be a good tracer of dark matter as well. But it turns out that this is only a good approximation when the clusters are relatively relaxed. Okay. But for example, I don't have it here, but if you go to this paper that we published, you can see the same contours based on X-ray. And what we see is that X-ray is a good approximation of the entire mass distribution only in cases like this, where the galaxy is relatively relaxed. But when galaxies are undergoing the big merger, like here or here, definitely the gas is not as good tracer as the intercluster like this. And it has a lot of sense if you think on that, because the gas during the collision is suffering a lot of shocks and also gets sometimes, so all these waves and so forth move the front of the shock compared to the central part of the image, no? where you have most of the stars and their matter distribution, which when they collide, they don't feel each other, but only gravitationally, okay? So and this is in fact what we observe, that the X-ray is only a good tracer of dark matter in relaxed situations.
Okay, another question. And I saw that your definition of R1, that you call that, and I like it very much, but I fear that it can be affected by interaction between galaxies because it's so big, so huge.
Yeah, in fact, this is a very good question, Jaime, because this is the entire basis of trying to the so the motivation of using a new definition of size was just to when you realize, I mean, I have been working with effective radio all my life.
Yeah.
So, and then in the last 20 years, with the arrival of Sloan and large surveys, everybody moved to use the effective radius as a measure of size, forgetting that in the past, people measured the size of galaxies using many different parameters. For example, the Humboldt radius, which was a sufa brightness. It was also the typical 25 magnitudes per square second size definition. So in the last 20 years, everybody, particularly the younger people, have forgetting totally about that because this is difficult to measure.
Yeah.
And everybody is using the effective radius as a size indicator. And that is fine. I mean, I'm not saying that you don't use the effective radius, but what I'm saying is that the effective radius is definitely not a measure of the spatial distribution of the galaxies. It's a measure of how the light is concentrated. And here you clearly see it again. So this is the effective radius of this galaxy. So if you use the effective radius and you say it's the size of the galaxies, the only thing that I'm asking you is to rethink of what you're saying before making any extrapolation of the meaning of that. Okay, because definitely it's not the spatial extension. And definitely it's not connected at all where the stars are formed. Okay, which would be something more closer to what your eye would see, like the end of the edge or the typical size of a galaxy. So for example, here again, answering your question, okay? So here you have that the location of the R1, so which is motivated physically for the star formation threshold. And you can see that very nicely enclosed the disk of this galaxy. And you see all this accretion material that is coming, it's outside that definition. So this doesn't mean that this material is not going into the center or is on top of this. It is, okay? But it gives you at least a framework to distinguish in between ex situ material that is being accreted, okay, from the stars that are being formed inside this radius. So I don't know whether this is answering your question. So.
Yes, from that point of view, I agree with that. Yes, on the other side, the effective radius is more a measure of a dynamical radius, something, but you know better than me.
Yes, but also that is absolutely fine. But my point is that when you claim that a galaxy like a dwarf, like the ultra-diffuse galaxy, have the size of the Milky Way, in your mind, this is misleading.
Yeah.
Because you think in an object like, let me show you again. Let me show you again this example. Here you go. If you say that this object has the size of the Milky Way, you are not understanding at all the nature of this object. Because you are not, and they have the same effective radius. Okay? But definitely they are not the same type of objects.
No, of course.
This is the reason why I think it's important to rethink on this aspect of what is the size of a galaxy. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Jaime.
Gracias.
Do we have more questions for Nacho?
Might have one.
I don't know. Olga Prieto, Almudena Prieto.
Yeah.
Okay. Hello. Yeah.
Hello. Hi, Nacho. Very nice talk.
Thank you very much.
Well, a parenthesis. I think the effective radius, I agree, is not a determination of the size, but it has to be seen how in the context is used. In my opinion, the effective radius relates where the potential dominates.
Yes.
I mean, but anyway, my question was, these ultra-diffuse galaxies show, or it's evident, they have very shallow potential. Very, very shallow. So there are probably galaxies in the make. And maybe compared with something like M87 or Milky Way, is interesting, of course. But I would say they remind me more like the satellites of the Milky Way, like the Sagittarius.
Exactly.
They are very spread, there are plenty of stars, we see the stars around. So the Magellanic clouds.
Exactly.
So it would not be a suggestion or idea, perhaps. What about putting the Magellanic, instead of taking the Milky Way or compare, what about taking the Magellanic clouds and putting it at the surface brightness of these
Exactly. This is what I'm trying to say. What I'm saying is that that this statement, 47 Milky Way sized extremely diffuse galaxies in the coma cluster. So here I reinforce again, Milky Way sized. It's making your way of interpreting these objects complicated because you are thinking on extensions of this order. So that is why I include in combination to very big galaxies, the location the comparison of an ultra diffuse galaxy with a dwarf. A typical dwarf of the same mass. This is a 10 to the 8 solar masses dwarf. So the only difference that you see between an ultra-diffuse galaxy and a dwarf here is that this dwarf has a lot of star formation here in the center, and that is why the effective radius of this dwarf is smaller compared to the ultra-diffuse galaxy where the star formation already went out, already exhausted some years ago. So what I'm saying basically is that if you take this galaxy and you make this evolve with time without new star formation, this would be equivalent to an ultra diffuse galaxy. This is what I'm saying.
Sorry, I didn't remove the video. Okay, so maybe it would be a good idea to faint the Magellanic clouds, for example, and see how they look like.
Exactly.
Also, just very short, because maybe we are running out of time, but when you maybe focusing in the optical alone, you are missing also another characteristics of the galaxy. So moving to the infrared and having images of this ultra diffuse light or extended part of the galaxy in different bands.
That would be amazing, yes.
Colors, simply image ratio will tell you a bit of hint of what kind of sources of structure and nature is behind producing that light.
That would be amazing. That would be really amazing. So we are trying.
Because you have these color images, so you can directly make it.
So I can tell you the line of our efforts on this sense. So, we are trying to think on doing this on the near infrared K band. Okay. And but it's extremely complicated from the ground base because the atmosphere is so bright that it really makes our life extremely complicated. In the space, you can see here a direct comparison of what you can do in the Sufa Branes profile, for example. For example, if you go at 3.6 micron, here you have, and this is in the ultraviolet as well. So this is again exactly the same, Almudena. So the light profile along the semi-major axis, okay? In deep data, in the optical, the green line in 3.3 micron from Spitzer, and in the ultraviolet from Galax. And in fact, you can see that we can do relatively good job at 28 magnitudes per square second. But the problem that we have found particularly with the Spitzer data, is that for the type of galaxies that you want to explore, which is these relatively nearby galaxies, the field of view of the cameras were not so big enough and complicate our life a lot, because we really need to have a good flat field subtraction and so forth. And so we are not limited. So I'm going to say this differently. We are at the moment limited not by the wavelength, if you go to the space, but by the size of the field of view of the cameras that allow us to explore these objects.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Almudena. Do we have more questions for Nacho? If not, I will thank again, Nacho. Thank you very much for this wonderful talk.
Thank you, you guys.
And that's all. I will send you the link for the video as soon as possible.
Thank you very much, everybody. Bye-bye.